to talk to you a little bit in this episode about tracheal mites. That's probably not a name that you've heard recently. Well, tracheal mites are mites that impact honeybees. And the reason we haven't heard a lot about them recently is because varroa, tropolalaps, all these other mites get so much more attention than do tracheal mites. But I want to spend a little bit of time in this video talking about tracheal mites, what to look for, and how to deal with it if you think you have a tracheal mite infestation in your honeybee colonies. So what is a tracheal mite? Well, tracheal mites were discovered in the UK in the 1920s. After that, they were discovered in other countries and only found their way to the US in the 1980s. When I started keeping bees in the early 1990s, tracheal mites were something that all beekeepers talked about. They worried about them. They treated for them. In fact, they were the first big mite issue that we had in the US and were superseded shortly thereafter by the introduction of varroa. And both of these mites now occur really all around the world. So focusing specifically on tracheal mites, these mites, as the name implies, infest the tracheal system of the honeybee. So a little bit about honeybee anatomy here to help you understand all of what I mean. Bees, of course, have heads, thoraces, and abdomens. And bees don't breathe through a nose or through a mouth like you and I do. Instead, they breathe through spiracles, which are openings that go down the sides of their bodies. Their thorax, the bee's thorax, is a ball of meat. Everything that moves the honeybee is attached to the bee's thorax. So when you open up that thorax, you're just going to see a lot of muscle. And what does muscle need in order to do its thing efficiently? It needs oxygen. So you get a very robust tracheal system in the thorax of the honeybee. And in fact, if you remove the head of a honeybee, remove a little collar around the top part of the thorax, you will see a very robust V-shaped tracheal system in that honeybee's thorax. So that V-shape comes up towards the head and then back down to the side of the thorax, and that trachea on both sides of the thorax exit the thorax at a little opening called a spiracle. So we have a very large spiracle here on one side of the honeybee thorax and a very large spiracle here, really at the base of the wings. And the tracheal mites use that spiracle to get into the tracheal system in the honeybee thorax because that's where the tracheal system is largest. So you get one female mite, potentially, who goes into that spiracle, into that tracheal system. She lays eggs, produces male and female offspring. Multiple mites might go into that bee and subsequently produce male and female offspring. And you'll get these almost miniature colonies of tracheal mites growing and developing in the tracheal system of the honeybee's thorax. This can lead to clogging of that tracheal system. It can lead to scar tissue in the tracheal system. And honestly, you could only truly diagnose a tracheal mite infestation if you, in fact, do a dissection looking for tracheal mites. So all of these tracheal mites reproducing in the bees means that at some point, some tracheal mites are going to want to come out of those spiracles and go to a new honeybee. And how they do that is they'll come out, go out of those spiracles, and they will engage in a behavior that we call questing. So questing is essentially mite hosting, host-seeking behavior. So they might sit on the surface of the bee with their front two legs up in the air like this, and when another bee passes them, they grab onto that bee, work their way around to the spiracle openings that are on the thorax of that bee, go into the spiracles, and now they're inside that big tracheal system that's in the bee's thorax, only to infest that new bee. And that tracheal mite on the outside of the bee knows to go to another bee because they recognize it by its cuticular hydrocarbons, certain hydrocarbon profiles that are associated with the cuticle of the bee. So this mite knows another bee is walking by it because it can smell it, essentially, get on that bee, go into the spiracle, and now it's infested the tracheal system of that bee. So what are some signs of infestation associated with tracheal mites? Well, there's really three big signs that you'll typically see anytime you have a colony infested with tracheal mites. The first of those is honeybees might display an anatomical abnormality called K-wing, the letter K. So think about it this way. Honeybees on both sides of their bodies have a forewing, which is really large, and a hindwing, which is smaller. And when bees fly, they hook the forewing to the hindwing on one side of the body with little hooks called hamuli, and that causes the two wings to beat in unison. Well, in a tracheal mite infestation, those wings may become unhinged and open up while the bee is at rest. So one side of the body's wings may be completely folded normally. The other side of the body's wings may have opened up, and it's essentially, it looks like the letter K, with the bee's body being the straight part and those two wings, the forewing and the hindwing, making this letter K. We call that K-wing. So one of the signs of infestation is K-wing. Another sign that you might typically see is bees crawling around the entrance of the hive, specifically on the ground, up around blades of grass. They're crawling up the grass and falling off. You'll see them on the ground around the entrance of the hive. The third big sign of infestation that you will typically see associated with tracheal mite infestation is that colonies coming out of winter seem to be slow to grow. They're slow to take off. They're almost lethargic. They've got these loose clusters. The bees just aren't responding well to environmental conditions. So they're very loose, they're not growing. There's all of these things associated with just general colony lapse in typical behaviors. And you often see this late winter, early spring, which makes sense. If heavily infested bees through winter are clustering tightly together with one another, that really makes it possible for tracheal mites to go in every direction and create this massive infestation in the nest. So again, K-wing, bees crawling on the ground around the entrance of the hive, or third, colonies that just won't grow coming out of winter and going into spring. Unfortunately, I've got two pieces of news for you that's going to make everything I just told you a little trickier to interpret. Piece of news number one, you really only can diagnose tracheal mite infestation through dissections of adult honeybees. So you can see those signs of infestation and not know for sure if it's tracheal mites, which leads to the second point that I'm going to make with this. Those signs of infestation, K-wing, bees crawling on the ground around the entrance of the hive, or just slow growth in spring, those are all associated with other pests and pathogens of honeybee colonies as well. So if you think you have a tracheal mite infestation, you can do one of things. You can treat the colony as if it had one, trying to address the tracheal mites, or you could collect bees and some alcohol, especially bees that are crawling around on the grass, and you can dissect them and look for tracheal mites, or you can send them off to someone who can provide that diagnostic service for you. In another video, we'll cover how to do tracheal mite dissections. It's very possible for beekeepers to do, but for now, if you are incapable of doing it, there are usually labs around the country where you reside where scientists can perform that service for you. Now, what do you do if you think you have tracheal mites? Well, there's really three things to do if you think you have tracheal mites. Number one, usually bees these days can be quite resistant to tracheal mites. That's probably one of the reasons we don't hear tracheal mites discussed at major conferences or beekeeper events anymore. That's because they're not really considered a serious problem. And some of that may be due to the fact that lots of stocks have been developed that may just have resistance to the mite. So changing out a queen could help, making sure you're using a stock that is documented resistance to tracheal mites. Those are really good ideas. Another option for you if you believe that you have tracheal mites is you can use a product that is menthol based. As we do these videos, I've tried to be very careful not to name specific chemical treatments because chemical treatment trade names change all the time. Some of them come in label, some of them leave label. I will simply say there is usually in many places a registered compound that has menthol as the active ingredient. Menthol is the same thing that we get in our cough drops when we're coughing or we're having a sore throat, except that these menthol packets usually have much higher concentrations of menthol. You can find them in the beekeeping equipment supply catalogs. You purchase those, you follow the label related to that packet, but it usually involves putting that packet of menthol in the hive, which will rid the bees of tracheal mites. The third option for tracheal mite control is actually the best option of all, and it's also the simplest option of all. You can mix vegetable oil, common vegetable oil, with powdered sugar to make a grease patty. If you look in the literature, you'll see things about grease patties associated with tracheal mites. It's basically cake icing. Liquid vegetable oil, powdered sugar, mixed together until you get a Play-Doh-like consistency that's not sticking to your hands, but that is still pliable. If you put a grease patty on the top bars of the frames in the bottom box of your hive, in other words, on the top bars of the frames of the box, that's your brood chamber, that will go a long way to controlling tracheal mites. So how does it work? Well, no one knows exactly for sure, but it likely has to do with that tracheal mites need to find a new host using cuticular hydrocarbons. So as the bees are working these grease patties, because there's sugar in them, their bodies are getting coated with grease, which might interfere with the tracheal mites' ability to find and move onto a new host. Regardless of how it works, it's very efficacious, it's not using a chemical control option, and it's safe to use really throughout the year, regardless of if you've got honey supers on your hive or not. Many beekeepers don't think about tracheal mites much anymore, and it might actually have to do with another mite, varroa. How are the two intimately linked? Well, if you think about it, beekeepers spend a lot of their management time trying to control varroa. So they're using chemicals in their colonies that are shown to impact varroa. Well, varroa is a mite. Tracheal mites are mites. So probably a lot of the compounds that are going into our hives against varroa have efficacy against tracheal mites. And that probably explains why beekeepers don't see and think about them so much. But I will say, be very careful, because all of this has put tracheal mites on the back burner in the typical beekeeper's head. So when he or she comes out of winter with their colonies and they see struggling colonies, they go to pesticides or nutrition or bad queens or Nosema or something like that. If you believe you have tracheal mites, you could always treat as if you do, or you can collect bees, send them off for analysis to confirm that tracheal mites are present before you make a treatment designation. But keep in mind, these mites haven't been eliminated. They are out there, so they can still pose a risk to your bees.